The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he had sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord. I love blueberries. I don't know about you, but I feel really fortunate, really happy, that we can have them all year long. When you go into the supermarket in town, and the sliding doors open before you as you enter, almost right in front of you there, all the fresh fruits and vegetables. But my eye goes to the blueberries. Are they right in the same spot, or did they move them a little bit maybe? What do they look like? Are there a few in the little skinny containers? Or do they have that abundance of the really big containers of blueberries? Are they the small ones, or are they the really large ones this week? I can't wait to see them, because I know I'm going to be having them pretty much every day with my cereal or my oatmeal for breakfast. And even just going into the store and getting ready to buy them, I can almost begin to taste them. Look at the color of the blueberry, such a rich, deep color. Look at the plumpness, the juiciness. You can picture it, you can almost taste it already. And as I said, it's amazing, really, that we can have blueberries all year long. Do you look at the package when you pick it up? It's almost like a little game, isn't it? Where are they from now? Chile? Argentina? Michigan? Canada? My goodness, sometimes even from New Jersey. But they're always good. And they are always available. At least they're always available for us in Allendale, right here at the local supermarket. You know, when I walk in and I'm looking at what I'm going to buy, I'm not only looking forward to and grateful for those fresh, juicy, tasty blueberries. I'm always amazed at how much of everything there is. So many choices and in such abundance. And I know as I begin my shopping with the blueberries and begin to think of everything else I'm going to put into my cart, I know that for me, Father Charlie, living in Allendale, there is no chance that I need to worry about going hungry, there is no chance that I need to worry if I'm going to find what I need for good nutrition. No worry whatsoever. In fact, I might even say I feel kind of blessed about it. I'm blessed to have fresh blueberries all year long. But then I read, listen, or pray with the Beatitudes of the Gospel tonight. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they who mourn. The meek. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Who are merciful, who are clean of heart. Who are peacemakers. Who are persecuted and insulted because of Jesus. And then I'm not so sure that I'm blessed. Blueberries seem a little trivial in the light of the Beatitudes, don't they? Jesus Christ, in speaking to those who he's called to himself on that mountain where he's teaching them, as he calls them to himself, he speaks to them God's blessings. And he speaks to them God's blessings in a way that 2,000 years ago, and let's face it, I think today, kind of turn upside down the way people are used to thinking about feeling or being blessed. I think maybe those words come across our mouths a little too easily, or even a little too tritely at times. I know they do for me. Sometimes perhaps we speak of being blessed in a way that's really about passing things, or things of comfort or convenience or luck. I keep remembering those blueberries and how tasty they are and how happy I am to have them and how I know any day I can walk or drive right over and pick them up. But I know that's not really a blessing. I know that the Beatitudes, which we hear today, but really are familiar to us, we're really being reminded of them, not hearing them anew. I know that these Beatitudes are saying to me that God's blessing is announced to those who are hurting. God's blessing is announced to those who are struggling. God's blessing is announced to those who are suffering. And most especially to those for whom this is not a momentary affliction, but really a way of life. To those who live in situations, for the most part, that we will not encounter, or if we encounter, that we will not find our daily life. As I listen to these Beatitudes that Jesus proclaims, these blessings, I can't help but think that as he's turning upside down the way people look at blessings, that I'm being turned upside down a little bit too. A word that's become more spoken in recent years is the word privilege. And maybe privilege now has become a cliche even. People will cynically maybe or angrily tell people to check their privilege, as if it were something we could set aside. But we know that if we're living in this area, we do enjoy many privileges, don't we? And so when I hear Jesus speaking to his disciples, these Beatitudes, these blessings, I think he's speaking to them on a bridge. They are going to experience this persecution of which he's speaking. They're going to experience hardship. But he wants them to be aware, I believe, that it's not only their hardship. He's trying, I believe, to shake them up, wake them up a little bit more, to know that they are called to be among those for whom these hardships are ways of life. And so maybe for we who are privileged in many ways, you and I, maybe these Beatitudes are meant to shake us up a little bit more, to recognize the privileges that we have so that we can be vigilant and not take them for granted in our own lives, but also to recognize that, like the disciples that Jesus called close to himself on that mountain, the gospel being proclaimed is meant to call us close to the Lord also. That we know that we're meant to be with and among those who are not privileged. That we're meant to live in unity with all those who live in hardship and suffering and struggle. Jesus turned the blessings upside down 2,000 years ago, but we know we still have to be among those who are turning them upside down today. We know that our culture continues to proclaim, I would say continues to shout, blessings that are not found here. Our culture proclaims, blessed are the powerful, or we're blessed are the wealthy, and that's not found in the gospel, is it? We have to constantly remind ourselves, all of that is passing. All of that is passing. And we're called to walk in the footsteps of Christ, who made himself neighbor to the oppressed and lived amongst those who suffered. A few minutes ago, we were, in a good way, I would say, privileged to pray with and for Allie, our candidate for full communion in the Catholic Church. Allie has been drawn to the beautiful faith that we share, not here, but the church throughout the world. And being drawn to that, she's already been gathering with some of our parishioners to break open God's word, to walk with Jesus as she already has, but to begin to walk with Jesus with us in the Catholic Church. I don't know about you, but that ritual that we experienced of Allie being marked with the cross, being marked all over herself, her person, with the cross, I always find it so moving because I rejoice with the candidate, with Allie. I rejoice with her to see what God's doing in her life. But I also rejoice to know that when we experience that ritual, that we are blessed too. If we let those words and that blessing and that ritual shake us up and maybe turn us upside down a little bit too. Do our ears hear? Do our eyes see? Do our lips proclaim? Does our heart house the Lord? Do our shoulders, our hands, and our feet do God's work? Those blueberries are awfully good, aren't they? But the blueberries won't sustain me or you. They're tasty. They're beautiful to behold. They are created by God, but they're passing. The happiness of blueberries with my morning breakfast might last a little while, maybe through the day, I suppose, but it's a passing happiness. We're created for something more. We're created to be blessed by God, to find our happiness in God, to find unity with God. And so blessed are you, blessed am I, when that sinks in deeply. Blessed are you, blessed are we, when that awareness helps us free ourselves from false idols or passing trends. Blessed are we when that reality draws us to use all that God gives us to lift up those who are downtrodden and overlooked in our world and help them know that they are the ones especially that our Lord looks on tenderly. That they and we are all created to live in God's blessings in unity together.
The message that you may have received, how well he did as a preacher doing the homily, and we're going to try not to monopolize. So hopefully I won't do much talking. I tend to do that. First question is, how did God's word touch your life today? Or what did you experience in hearing God's word today?
Really, when you think about it, all the powerful, the rich, the whatever, they're the ones that get all the notice. The poor, the homeless get very little notice these days, and that really brought that to mind.
I enjoyed how he reminded us, where we live is kind of a bubble, and that there's a lot going on outside of our bubble. And it's important for us to make sure that we share what we have, that we don't forget those that are outside the bubble, and that we care for our brothers and sisters and remember how blessed we are, how incredibly blessed we are.
I think it's the blessing that we receive in our lives around here is pretty obvious. I mean, we all live pretty good lives as far as I can tell. And this is something that I actually pray about every day, is that people get together, and he brings it across pretty much all the time, is to go out and help other people any way you can, just to be in service of God. And I thought it was good, and I know he likes blueberries a lot more than I thought.
It brought back an experience I had this week where I picked up a homeless man in Route 17, and just the whole attitude he had about not needing anything, not wanting anything, and he was very much at peace. I found just such an attraction to him because he had such peace about him. And when I asked him what I could do for him, could I bring him somewhere, you bring him to a shelter, he said no. He just wanted to go to the mall. And, I took him to the mall, and we had some conversations, and I, tried to get him fed and all that. But it was just one of those experiences where I met this person, and I saw God. Because there was just such an emptiness of materialism and anything that was pretentious. And it just really warmed my heart to have met this person. One wanted me to, I wanted to do more for him. And he just, at that time, didn't let. So it was a very interesting experience and tied very much into what we were talking about.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. So just to reiterate the question, we're talking about the homily, and the first question is, how did God's word touch your life today, or what did you experience in hearing God's word today? So if you want to give that a thought, did you want to?
I think we're already on number two.
All right, so I'll do my little takeaway on number one. A few things. One, we talk about Allendale and our lifestyles here in Bergen as blessings, and I think these are more privileges. That's kind of one of the takeaways I got, that we're very privileged, and to be blessed is if we were to take those blueberries and bring them to someone like a homeless person who didn't have those, that would be something that would be blessed. That would be a blessing for that person to have those blueberries and to share something that, we take for granted all the time. It's quite astonishing that those blueberries are available all year round to us, something that a lot of people never get to eat at all.
Right.
So, I look at all the things that I have in my life, and when something doesn't go right, I get upset about it, and I'm like, it makes me think, really? Turn that upside down. What about the folks who never even have that ever, never have that experience ever? And who am I to be upset about something that's in their world just nothing, right? It doesn't even exist. So turning that upside down and trying to put my mind in other people's shoes, and then realize what blessings I have, and to go out and share those blessings. Anyone else? All right, so.
Well, I think it reminds me, your comments remind me of when there was the tragedy in Haiti where the American people donated more money than anyone but the American government, any other country. They donated more more money to Haiti than, you know, anyone from any other nationality or any other government, except for the United States, which I think tells us, you know, like what happened at 9/11, how generous people are when there's tragedy in this country. The thing is we're not always generous when there isn't tragedy. We don't rise up as much when there isn't tragedy, and I think that's what we have to do more. And I think that's where, you know, we seem to fall down somewhere.
That one of the things that I got from it is that God is seeking the humble, and that the blessings that the world, being in the world, not necessarily of the world, blessings are things that we have, what we live every day here in Allendale. We take our heat for granted, we take this for granted. But the blessings can also be found in our struggles that we have in our daily lives. And if we're also able to take those struggles, like take the cross, our struggles, and let God help us through them. And that's a blessing. And I think that that's something that I got, that blessed are the poor in spirit, because, you know, to whatever we have to journey with God.
So, second question, what differences will God's word make in your week?
I'll start with that one. I pray every day, I'm sure, I guess all of you do. I make sure that I say my prayers every night. And the difference is, and I look forward to it, doing it, because I get like one chance, but I find myself doing it during the day. Sometimes I go outside and take a break and just think about something like, wow, it would be good if this could happen and we could, everybody could help more. So it's with me. That's all I can say.
I think that God's word tonight is going to make me stop complaining, even just to myself.
Or to me.
About things that, you know, maybe we don't have, or maybe we should be doing, and maybe just be more thankful that we do have what we do have, and to try to find a way to share what we have with somebody else. Even, you know, if it's your time, or it doesn't always have to be money, but time or food, or your love with other people, because we really have to share with our brothers and sisters, and that really came through tonight.
I agree, Lucy. I agree. It did come through, and I find the difference that it'll make in my week will be, they'll know us by our actions. So even if it's just a smile, or getting something off the shelf for somebody at the grocery, or just, I will try to take that with me and be more sensitive. I won't pick up homeless on the but I will try to be more sensitive to others, right?
Well, I think, you know, it goes back to one of the prayers that we say every day is that, you know, send somebody to us in need and help us help them so that we can be of service to them, and in that, you know, doing that, serve God. And one of the things is not just that, you know, sending somebody to us, but also us recognizing that person's need and recognizing a way that we can help them. I think that's very, you know, very much part of our prayers and what we need to do every day. Because a lot of times people are around us and we just don't recognize that they need something. And
be somebody's angel.
Yeah, everybody cares.
Everybody's a guardian angel at some point in time. And hopefully, you know, we can do that more.
I think after what you were saying about, you know, picking that homeless guy, I was honestly shocked to hear you say that, because I would never do something like that either. You know, I mean, they scare you nowadays with all the stories on the news about, you know, the guy could have like a gun in his pocket or something, you know, so I wouldn't be the first person to, you know, stop somebody on the street like that, but it's out of my comfort zone. But I think, you know, going forward, I'm going to, you know, try to kind of reach that sort of comfort zone and, you know, take a risk and do something that I wouldn't always necessarily do for somebody else just because of the fear or whatnot. Maybe not pick somebody up on the street, but, you know, something, little baby steps.
Mm-hmm. think one of the things that struck me that I'll carry into this week was when Father Charlie mentioned about let being blessed shake us up a little bit, you know, and what does that do? Our shoulders and our hands, do we do our God's work, you know, during the week? Are we the peacemakers? And so, like, one of the things that I thought when he said that, also is when the disciples were, when he chose the disciples, they weren't going to have it easy. In fact, they were going to die for him. And, you know, but what he was saying was that they're chosen to do his work, and that they will have eternal happiness, basically, and that it's all worth it. And so we just need to remember that in our lives, in our daily lives, for each other. And then, like you said, Brenda, it's like it could be a smile to somebody that it's pretty good.
Well, at my age, what God is going to do for me this week and every week to come, I'm just happy enough that I can get out of bed in the morning and do His will and spread the gospel as much as possible. And I try to live by the cross.
I'm a listener.
That's okay.
I just love to spread love, though. I think you all know that.
Yes,
the way I am.
Rice pudding is pure love.
Yes. So I was struck by some of the images in Father Charlie's story that he brought across. The way he explained the taste and smell and the textual content of the blueberries, and trying to, you know, really get us to think about something that's what we feel is really, really good in our lives, and then turn that upside down. And what I got from the upside down concept was, what if I gave up something that gives me those warm and fuzzies, the blueberries that he gets, and gave those away for a week, and in that time, or in spending whatever it is that I do to enjoy that, do something similar to someone else who doesn't necessarily get that. So maybe buy a meal for somebody who doesn't, or go to the soup kitchen and give food to folks who don't normally get food but would obviously like to have that food, or maybe take someone to a show or something where they normally weren't able to because they don't have a lot of money and they don't get to go to shows, or give someone a gift who normally doesn't get a gift. Something along those lines. I haven't really identified what I want to do, but I think it's a two-part thing. One, for me to give something up, and then to give in place of that to someone else. And I think in doing that, I'm going to somewhat experience what was asked of the apostles, which is to give up your daily life, your the fishing and the results of that, the reaping of that reward, and give someone else that reward that who doesn't get that reward in some way. And I'm sure I can think of something to go out and do. I mean, there's lots of the food pantry. I could go out and help them organize or something in that space. There's plenty of things that we could do around here to supplement or replace that blueberry experience, and hopefully give someone else that blueberry experience. And then from there, I'll get the reward of having to help someone. And I think that's the sharing, and that's the real blessing, is to get that feeling that I actually did something for someone else. The rat race gets in the way, and I don't experience that feeling of goodness by doing something for someone else. I probably would have picked up the homeless person, but I don't see a homeless person on the road every day. So what can I do something every day without driving around looking for homeless people, right? I'm sure there's plenty of things we could do. So that was my take, and hopefully I'll be able to do something this week on that. So the third question is, are there ways in which today's preacher might have improved in communicating the message?
I'd just like to say, over the past year, Father Charlie is studying and doing, you know, these courses. His preaching has just gotten so much better. and such, so much more effective. I think everything, this wasn't even one of his more powerful homilies. I think he's just been doing a wonderful job in bringing more feeling and emotion into his homilies for the last year or two. And I'm just very impressed with him. I asked him to, you know, tell me who his coach was. I'd love to study under whoever it is.
Well, I really think when he was starting out, and you know, I had already read the readings earlier in the week for something else, so I knew what the gospel was the Beatitudes. And then he read it tonight. When he started out with the blueberries, I was a little lost for a couple of, you know, but it started to dawn on me, like what Rich said, that when you have something like that and that's so important to you, and we think of that as not really the biggest thing in the world. I mean, you know, to be able to have blueberries every day, and then you think, all of those people that, you know, don't have that or don't have many of the things. And so I think that was a good way to communicate it to anybody, you know, even younger people to older people could understand that. So I thought that was a good point.
For me, it would have been chocolate chip cookies, but I thought, when he said blueberries, I pretty much kind of knew right where he was going. And I thought, I mean, I listen every week to his homilies, and I thought he really brought each point across really well, each of the eight Beatitudes and what, you know, what we have versus what a lot of people don't. And, you know, if you don't already think about it, you should be, and you should be trying to do something for the less fortunate and those who don't have the same privileges as we do. And I know for Lou and I, it's something we always think about. And so hopefully everybody else gets the message.
I wish everyone would get the message on coming to Mass to bring one can of whatever is requested for that month. One can of tomato. If you look at how many people are in the congregation, you could fill their quota at one weekend,
yeah,
and start another one. And I used to send out messages, but it kind of fell by the wayside. But I still try to do my part to bring one can and try to encourage anyone else that I can. I think that would help the food pantry a lot.
I think, because Brendan and I actually heard him give a homily twice today. We had a funeral this morning. And the funeral this morning was interesting. And I was talking to him afterwards, and he had planned on drawing from some things that were, you know, said in the eulogy, but that didn't end up working out for whatever reason. And so he had to kind of do an impromptu homily. And obviously this one, you know, you could tell he really had it planned out, obviously, because this was for his class and everything. And this morning it was a little less prepared, but I kind of found that I almost enjoyed this morning's one even more, only because it had a little bit more of that kind of spontaneity to it, and more of him. And a little less like academia or whatever, you know, you want to call it. So I feel like if there was one thing to improve, we're all like polishing and everything, so critique, I guess. But like to, you know, maybe get a little bit more spontaneity into it, make something happen.
Well, I gotta believe that he was probably a little bit more nervous tonight,
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Because it was being filmed. Because usually he seems to have a very natural flow, mm-hmm. since he's been doing this, and that's one of the big improvements I think he's made in the last year or so.
It's the spontaneity.
And the spontaneity, right. And just the more casual approach to giving the homily versus a very mechanical, right. Reading type of, mm-hmm. homily. And I think he's really come a long way and done a great job on that.
I've always enjoyed his homilies.
But they've really taken.
They have gotten better.
But as the cantor, sometimes I'm like, remember the time when he looked over and started having me saying something?
Oh yeah, for the First Communion homily?
Like he
so
would
we
say...
had this really rough crowd for First Communion homily, and they just were like so... It took about 5 minutes for him on the microphone to get quiet down at the beginning of the Mass. I mean, it was really just a rough crowd. And so his homily then was to have them re-sing the psalm after every point that he was making, kind of like a Baptist homily.
It was a
say
Baptist
amen
homily.
And it was like,
I loved
she
it.
Was sitting over there like, you know, just
I loved it. He just cut me that look, and I'm like, oh, I know that look. I was raised Southern Baptist, so.
Children's Crossing, too.
Yeah, okay, so you know, you just see that look and you're like, okay, I'm going to sing, I got it, Father. I would, with this particular homily, I would have tightened it more, maybe cut some things out and just made it just, does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
A little less, mouth-watering discussion.
Yeah, that might have been a little, maybe a couple minutes shorter there, but.
Yeah, but everything else was needed.
Yes.
It was necessary.
Yes.
Well done, very well done.
So, go ahead.
It seems to me the last question that Father Charlie is looking for some input. And we are God and country. And I feel if he would just mention country a little more in his homilies and just let everyone know that we still live in a country where we can sit and still have a meeting like this. We're in a free country and he should let everybody know that.
So I've been sitting here thinking and hearing everyone and just a few things that I picked up on. He did have a little spontaneity with respect to Allie. I don't think Allie, yes. His comments with respect to Allie were in his prepared homily. I thought he did a nice job of bringing that in. I didn't really pick up too much on nervousness. I thought he was quite comfortable up there. I think he's a very comfortable speaker. If I had to try to find some area of improvement, which I don't think there really is, but if I had to, I'd probably say maybe something in a message towards the younger crowd, if he could have possibly given an example. And then another thing is, there was a lot of implied action in the homily, which I took away just on the way he said the homily. I don't know if everyone else did as well, but I saw a lot of implied action in the homily, and perhaps some people didn't, and maybe if he maybe interjected a little bit about how we could do something, like the example I gave with replacing the blueberries.
Like,
if there was a call to action statement that I just got, and there was quite a few, I could go on for hours on, quite a few things that I picked up on, but maybe if he interjected something in there for all of us to walk away this week to take an action. That would be my feedback. Okay, so.
I have one.
Oh, of course, please.
I always admire Father Charlie's homilies, and I always like to comment that there's usually something that I take from it, always, and I share it with him after Mass. And this evening, well, this was the kickoff to Be My Witness. And so I personally picked up like some analogies with the disciples and with us. And if there was anything, maybe there could have been some sort of tie into this big program that's coming during Lent for the parishioners and related to them, to us. That, like when he was talking about the disciples, and we're talking about helping the homeless and so forth, well, our neighbors are each other. We all have lives, we all have things like going on that aren't easy. It's not just the homeless. It's not just the hungry for food. It's the hungry, it's loneliness, it's marital issues, it's problems with teenagers, it's life that people are experiencing that we as brothers and sisters could be helping each other with. And when we're getting together in these small communities and reflecting on the scripture, that's the whole point, is how are we applying our day-to-day life to our faith and to draw each other, to support each other through that. And I think that something like that could have been incorporated into the homily to have a segue into this is what's coming and this is for you, and this could be nourishing, spiritually nourishing.
So that's kind of your call to action piece that,
yes.
Right.
That I'm picking up on a little bit. Great. Anyone else have anything else? I think we're pretty much at our 30 minutes. I think we may have actually gone over a little bit.
Not too bad.
I think we'd be great, and thank you, everybody. I really appreciate it. Father Charlie, awesome job.
Yes.
Thank you, Father Charlie.
Thank you, Father Charlie.
Thank you. We love you.
Thank you.
Sorry, we will
thank you,
name him.
No worries.
We're going to name him.